1969, when the Surveyor 3 camera from the Apollo 12 capsule returned to Earth from the moon, Streptococcus mitis, a common bacterium from the human mouth, was found. Initially, NASA thought that the camera hadn't been properly sterilized on Earth before the launch 2.5 years earlier. However, this would have been shocking, as it would mean the bacterium had survived that long on the moon, something that seems almost impossible. This bacterium lives inside the human mouth and cannot survive long outside the body, even in terrestrial environments, let alone on the moon. It is a mesophile, meaning it can survive only within a narrow range of human body temperatures. Even extremophiles, bacteria that can survive extreme environments, are unlikely to endure the moon's extreme temperature fluctuations, which reach 107 degrees Celsius by day and negative 150 degrees Celsius by night. Such dramatic swings in temperature would rupture bacterial cells. So, what happened? Well, it turns out that the camera might have been contaminated on Earth after its return and may never have actually been to the moon. The participants who examined the camera had poor space probe hygiene, wearing short-sleeve scrubs with their arms exposed. Their scrub shirt tails were also higher than the float bench level, allowing particulates from inside the shirts to potentially transfer onto the camera. Nevertheless, this incident opened up the possibility that life could survive on the moon. Since ancient times, humans have imagined the moon harboring its own life forms, a concept often explored in fiction. Before the creation of the telescope, there were many beliefs and depictions suggesting that the moon was inhabited by creatures. In the year 100, Plutarch, a Greek historian, posited that the moon was inhabited by other human civilizations. In fiction, one of the earliest known works to include outer space and alien life forms was A True Story, a title that would later be betrayed by its own content. Written in the 2nd century by Lucian of Samosata, it depicted the moon as having its own life forms, with a king who went to war with the king of the sun. However, the book shouldn't be taken seriously, as it also depicted Earth with fish people, a sea of milk, and an island of cheese. The book also depicted sinners being punished for writing false histories, with Herodotus and Theseus, famous historians whose works might as well be fiction, among them. Lastly, it ended with Lucian promising a sequel that never happened, the biggest lie of all. The book is a work of satire, meant to mock literary liars like Homer and Herodotus. Ironically, it is the only truthful mythological story ever written, as it openly admits to all its lies. In the 10th century, the tale of the bamboo cutter, a Japanese folktale, tells of a mysterious moon princess who grows up on Earth after being adopted by a bamboo cutter and his wife. The princess captivates the people of Earth, but in the end, she must return to the capital of the moon, leaving many brokenhearted. This tale is one of the earliest known works to suggest that the moon is inhabited and that travel between the moon and Earth is possible. After the creation of the telescope, many stories depicted the moon as inhabited and reachable by an aerial carriage. In the galoshes of fortune, a watchman was sent flying to the moon after putting on a pair of magical galoshes that granted wishes. There, he met moon men who, like us, wondered if Earth was inhabited. The marvelous and incredible adventures of Charles Thunderbolt in the moon and the Princess of the Moon, a Confederate fairy story, both portrayed the moon as accessible through machines designed for space travel. In Dr. Dolittle in the Moon, the doctor, gifted with the ability to talk to animals, reached the moon on the back of a giant moth. There, he discovered astonishing flora and fauna, massive insects, intelligent plants with their own language, and a single human inhabitant, a prehistoric man who had grown into a giant due to the moon's unique food and conditions. These stories were fantastical in nature, but some fiction was loosely based on science. In The Man in the Moon by Francis Godwin, the main character traveled to the moon and, to his surprise, found what he called another Earth. It had plants, animals, and most surprisingly, a utopian society. The inhabitants, known as the Lunars, were not just any society, but a Christian one. Tall people who lived a happy and carefree pastoral life. Order was maintained by swapping delinquent children with those from Earth. They spoke a language of tunes and strange sounds, and their society possessed remarkable precious stones with unique properties. Some could generate heat, others produce light, and some even altered weight. In their dream, published in 1634 by Johannes Kepler, the moon was depicted as being inhabited by Lavania, which was divided into two hemispheres, Prevolva, which never saw Earth, and Subvolva, which saw Earth as their moon. Lavania's conditions were extreme, with harsh temperatures and an alien ecosystem. Some descriptions were scientific, explaining how celestial events, like eclipses, would appear from the moon, while others were more fictional, featuring supernatural beings like demons and unusual life forms adapted to lunar conditions. In the discovery of a world in the moon, John Wilkins speculated that the moon could be inhabited by selenites, moon dwellers similar to humans. He suggested that they might be rational beings, just as Earth has rational humans, but adapted to different conditions. Wilkins did not describe their physical appearance, instead focusing on the possibility of their existence. He believed the moon had an atmosphere and water, allowing life to thrive. Its surface might contain forests, rivers, and fertile lands, just like Earth. The reduced gravity would make movement easier, possibly allowing the selenites to leap great distances. Wilkins, being a clergyman, used his lunar speculation to argue that God could create life beyond Earth, countering the belief that celestial bodies were barren. He supported the idea of pluralism, which suggested that multiple worlds could support life, aligning with theological reasoning rather than just scientific observation. One of the most absurd works, however, almost convinced everyone that moon had life. It was called The Great Moon Hoax, a series of six articles published in The Sun in 1835, falsely attributed to Sir John Herschel, a real mathematician and astronomer. It claimed to have discovered life and civilization on the moon, describing creatures like bison, single-horned goats, mini zebras, unicorns, bipedal tailless beavers, and bat-like winged humanoids who built temples. These discoveries were supposedly made using a revolutionary telescope, larger than any other in the world. Eventually, the author claimed the telescope was destroyed when its lens acted like a burning glass, focusing the sun's rays and setting fire to the laboratory. The hoax went undiscovered for several weeks, and the articles were never officially retracted. However, a month after publication, The Sun admitted they were fabricated. The success of the hoax can be attributed to the common beliefs of the time, as even within scientific circles, the idea that the moon could be inhabited by sophisticated life was plausible. John Herschel's father, William Herschel, had once attempted to document life on the moon. In 1778, he believed he had observed lunar towns, though by the 1880s, further observations made it less likely that the moon had inhabitants. Even after the hoax was exposed, some continued to insist that the moon was inhabited. In 1838, Reverend Thomas Dick claimed that the moon was home to rational creatures, capturing the public's imagination in the early 1800s. The 1846 textbook, The Young Astronomer External, stated that many astronomers believed the moon was inhabited. Throughout the century, many authors treated lunar life as practically a fact. Richard Locke created the hoax to mock the absurd claims of writers like Thomas Dick, who insisted the moon had life. However, what he intended as satire was instead widely accepted as scientific fact. Despite all that, by the end of the 1800s, it was clear that the moon was devoid of life, as more powerful telescopes and better models for gravity and the moon's atmosphere were developed. Yet, some writers still found ways to imagine life on the moon. In H.G. Wells's 1901 novel, The First Man in the moon was depicted as a barren wasteland until the characters discovered the selenites, insect-like creatures living beneath its surface. So, while the moon's surface was lifeless, some still imagined that strange beings might inhabit the depths below. In the 20th century, as moon travel became a reality, scientists explored the last possibilities of life on the moon. Carl Sagan, in his doctoral thesis, wrote about the potential for lunar organics, and he, along with Isaac Asimov, helped develop a curriculum on what to do if astronauts encountered organic material on the moon. Concerns about contamination even influenced quarantine procedures for returning astronauts. But as the Apollo missions provided direct observations, the fantasies of life on the moon crumbled. And when humans finally set foot on its surface, the moon landing didn't just disprove the old myths, it buried them. With the dream of finding life on the moon gone, a new vision emerged, not of discovering life, but of bringing it there ourselves. With this search for lunar life ending, the focus shifted to bringing life there ourselves. Soon, the moon could have inhabitants, and they would be us. Humans may be among the first complex life forms to set foot on its surface. But we are only just beginning. NASA plans to send astronauts back to the moon by the 2030s, building on the legacy of Apollo 11's Tranquility Base, the first temporary moon base in 1969. Today, two major programs aim to establish permanent lunar settlements: the US-led Artemis program and the Chinese-led International Lunar Research Station. Living there, though, would have its challenges. To live there, we first need to find the right place. Lunar conditions are extreme, with temperatures ranging from negative 258 degrees Celsius to 123 degrees Celsius. The atmosphere is almost non-existent, meaning no protection from meteorites or radiation. The dust is also toxic. Astronauts reported it making their eyes water and their throats sore. Staying there long-term would be even more dangerous. So, we need shelters that can protect us from all that. One way is using liquid hydrogen, since its particles are small enough to block cosmic rays. But that would be expensive. A better option is using lunar soil as a shield. Some scientists have explored 3D printing bricks from lunar soil using solar power, so maybe we could turn it into a building material. The North or South Pole would be a good place to settle, since there's evidence of water. Their constant sunlight also makes them great for solar power. Another option is using lunar lava tubes, underground tunnels that would protect us from meteorites, radiation, and extreme temperature shifts. Inside, the temperature would stay around negative 23 degrees Celsius, and we could install heaters for warmth. Next, we need breathable air. Experiments on the ISS have shown that plants can be used to produce oxygen, which can then be circulated into habitation pods. Another option is extracting oxygen from lunar soil using heat and electricity, since about 42% of it is oxygen. Then there's water. Ice has been found at the moon's poles, and rovers could drill into the surface to collect it. If we can extract and purify enough, it could support a lunar colony. Next, we need to grow our food. Lunar soil doesn't have reactive nitrogen, which is essential for plants. It's also dusty and full of toxic compounds that would make plant growth difficult. But we could get around this by adding human manure, which would bind toxic metals, add nutrients, and retain water. The only things we would need to bring from Earth are seeds and earthworms, as they would help create a good ecosystem for our lunar food. In 2019, scientists managed to harvest tomatoes, peas, radishes, cress, and rye from simulated lunar soil. It's still in its infancy, but it's a step in the right direction. Soviet experiments in the 1970s showed that crops could grow with the moon's 354-hour day and night. In 2019, China also showed that seeds could sprout and grow in protected conditions on the moon, becoming the first plants ever to sprout on another world. But without heat, they died in the cold lunar night. Lastly, we need energy, and one way to get it is through solar power. Without an atmosphere, there are no clouds to block sunlight, making solar panels highly efficient. Lunar soil could also be useful, as it contains almost all the materials needed to build solar panels. But there's a problem. The moon's nights last 354 hours. One solution is to live at the poles, where sunlight is nearly constant. This would also make it easier to gather ice for water. A nuclear fusion reactor could also be built on the moon. The Japanese spacecraft Kaguya confirmed the presence of uranium and thorium on the lunar surface, though the concentrations are relatively low. If we can extract enough, a fission reactor could provide reliable energy for a lunar colony. There may be no life on the moon or anywhere else in our solar system, but we can bring life and spread it across the universe. We've already crashed tardigrades on the moon, sent countless microbes hitching rides on our spacecraft, and even left our own waste there, for reasons I can't even explain. Yet, the hope of finding life beyond Earth isn't lost. We've discovered the building blocks of life on asteroids, and with the right conditions, life might emerge in some unknown corner of the universe. If that happens, it could finally answer the question we've been asking for so long, or raise even bigger ones. If life can arise elsewhere, then Earth may not be so special. Just one of many places where nature has experimented with existence. And if that's true, the universe may be teeming with life, waiting to be found, or waiting to find us. Thank you for watching, and a special thanks to my patrons for your support. If you'd like to see more, I have bonus content on Patreon, and it's a great way to support my work if you enjoy what I do. Last time, I made a video about premature burial, how humans have used it as a tool of cruelty, punishment, and vengeance. Because of this, he developed a deep fear of being buried alive. If you haven't seen it yet, you might find it interesting. Anyway, the moon is fascinating, and there's so much more to explore, but I can't cover it all in one video. So, I'll probably talk more about it in the future. Thanks again for watching, and have a great week. Bye!